I want to thank the organizers first for inviting me. It was a long time. I first time came here in 91. Actually, I just spoke with a gentleman who is helping us, and he's working here from 1990. So always I was coming, he was there. I mean, it was extremely helpful all the time. And it was always wonderful to be here. It was many exciting results and talks were announced in this room. So it's really nice. The two characters which I'll discuss will be renormalization and rigidity, and they are related. And since here was a 10 lectures, I think, of Marco Martens, who introduced renormalization in some details, it will help me, but I also plan to define most of the object I'll need. So it is related to what Marco Martens discussed, and it is also related to what Stefano Marmi discussed. And I would remind you that Stefano discussed interval exchange maps, and he started with the simplest exchange of two intervals, which is a circle rotation. And so the usual picture here is that if you consider unit circle, and which is represented by this 0, 1 interval, and then the map is given by a graph, and it consists of two pieces. The first piece is a linear piece with slope 1. It starts at point rho. And then, starting from point 1 minus rho, this is another piece which is exactly matching this point. And this represents circle rotation. So this map T rho is just a map which takes x to the x plus rho modulo 1. It's a rotation by angle rho. And most of interesting things from ergodic and dynamical point of view corresponds to irrational rho, but rationals are also important. And then next step, what Marmi was discussing, and he discussed what is called generalized interval changes, where he said, why should we consider this linear maps with slope 1? Why don't we consider nonlinear maps instead, which are monotone, but follow the same pattern? So we just replace this by something like this and like something like that. And just two independent pieces of monotone maps will be still matching positions of endpoints, this point and this point, this point and that point, but otherwise it's two basically arbitrary monotone functions, smooth ones. So two branches, I would like them to be smooth, and right smoothness for me is something like C2 plus alpha, because I would need some distortion arguments, so lower smoothness is possible, but it's always tricky. That's a good setting for the thing. So both pieces of smooth can be more smooth than that, of course. The smoother, the better. But I'm not putting any condition of a type of Stefano Marmi putting that derivatives are matching or derivative are equal to 1. It's just two pieces. Right? And what I'm getting here is a map with breaks. It's a circle map, homeomorphism circle, but it has two break points with breaks. So what are the breaks? It's points where first derivative of a map has jump discontinuity. So obviously, at this point, derivative from this side and from that side are different, not necessarily the same. And at this point, derivative on this side and that side is different, not necessarily the same. And actually, these two break points, so the point 0 and point 1 minus r, one minus rho is a trajectory of the same, lie on the same trajectory. So if we take point 1 minus rho and map it by the map T, which is now a nonlinear map, they will get to point 0. The image will be point 0. And so they belong to the same trajectory. And actually, these two break points, the two break points of this picture, two breaks, is equivalent, and I ask you to believe me, you can conjugate it to a system which have just one break point. It's equivalent to one break point. And so we come to a class of maps, which I will discuss first, and for which we have complete understanding by now. It took 25 years kind of to achieve this, and it was many papers with medical collaborators, and I would list them, Elena Wool, and Dima Khmelev, Alexei Teplinsky, and Sasha Korchich. And so I'll formulate results later on, and I would say whose results are there. But this is maps with one breakpoint. So that's the class of maps I want to look at. So it's a maps, map T belongs to C2 plus alpha outside of unique point, point of break. At the point of break, derivative at this point from the left is not equal to the is not equal to derivative from the right. Let minus and plus will be here. And both of them are positive. So there is no critical point. And if you think about what are the, so you have singularity of this break singularity at one point. And the parameter which characterizes the singularity, I'm sure Marco discussed critical circle maps or critical maps, whatever. So there is an order of critical point which characterizes the singularity. So here, parameter which characterizes the singularity is the ratio of these two numbers. So if it considers the ratio of these two numbers, this is a parameter, and this is a positive number, so there is no harm to take square root of it. It will be convenient for me. This C is a parameter which characterizes the strength of the break. And the aim of the rigidity theory is to show that if you have two maps with the same type of singularity, so if you have T1 and T2, and they have the same, both with one break, and the size of the break is the same, so they have the same type of singularity, and they have the same combinatorial structure, meaning that rotation number is the same and irrational. Sometimes, but most of the time, you have to put some Diophantine condition plus Diophantine condition. So the equivalent topologically and the singular local structure of singularity is the same, then you want to conclude that they're equivalent in a very strong sense, much stronger than topological. You kind of upgrade this fact that they're topologically equivalent to smooth equivalence. So you want to conclude that this information implies that after change of variables, given by phi, T1 and T2 are conjugated by phi, where phi is either C1 or preferably C1 plus epsilon, or maybe C2 or maybe C3, but at least C1 is where rigidity starts. That means that metrical properties are the same. So that's the aim, that's rigidity, to upgrade topological equivalence, which is given by Danjoie theorem, to higher level of. And usual tool here to achieve such things is renormalization. And the scheme of renormalization for circle maps is the following. It's always scheme of renormalization is the same. So you have kind of system of intervals, a system of sets, subsets, which are getting smaller and smaller. And instead of original dynamical system given by T1 or T2, you can see the first return maps on this increasingly smaller domains. And so you can see the high iterates of your map, but you can see it in a coordinate system where these decreasing intervals become of size 1. And then your hope is that if you do this procedure, then of course you'll forget details of this T1 and T2, but you will reveal universal features of the thing. So what you'll get will not depend on where they started from, but you'll see some universal feature. And that's the idea of renormalization method. So for circle maps, the intervals which people normally consider are the following. So here is the circle. You take any point, we call it mark point x0. It's at some point on a circle, unit circle. And then you form trajectory of this point by the map T. So this is T is a homeomorphism. I can define it on the level of homeo, but it will be all smooth later on. And we'll think that rotation number is irrational. So irrational rotation number would have continued fraction expansion given by partial quotients. And then I will also have approximations given by truncated continued fractions. So QN denominators of continued fractions of this PN over QN will be important here. So basically, intervals which we want to consider will be the following. XQN minus 1, it's a trajectory of this point. So from XI, which is equal to TI X0, and when I is equal to QN minus 1, you get this point, which should come close to X0. And then you have xqn. Size is not very important here, xqn on the other side. And this will be sequences. Next will be qn plus 1, qn plus 2, and they will be oscillating, coming closer and closer to x0. But so I stop at this level. I consider interval in, which is interval between xqn minus 1 and xqn. And I consider first return map in this interval. And so I define this first return map. And this first return map will have two pieces. One corresponding, if I start here, that I will have to iterate. So if I start in this one, I would have to iterate my map qn times to come back inside. And so if I consider tqn, or on this piece, I will have to iterate qn minus 1 time, because after qn minus 1, I come inside. That's point xqn plus qn minus 1. And I would rescale also coordinate system. So how you rescale it, I would think that this is kind of unit size. You can do it in different ways. But I'll just take a fine change of variables so that the coordinate of this point 0, let me put it in another color, this is 0, z coordinate of this point. And say if this point, that coordinate is minus 1, this fixes its size. After that, my coordinate system giving by z. So I call this coordinate z instead of x. It's a renormalized coordinates. It depends on n, but I don't indicate this here. And then I can define these two maps, which will be fn on z, which is equal to an on z, going from z to x, then applying t to the qn, and then going back to z coordinate. So that's a first renormalized map. And there is another renormalized map, which is defined here, qnz, which is the same coordinate system, an n minus 1, but iterated qn minus 1 rather than qn. So this pair of maps, fnz and gnz, is really first return map in the renormalized coordinate system. And that is a sequence of renormalizations which we want to study in the limit when n goes to infinity. And look what's going on with these things. So that's how renormalizations are defined. Notice that this is z as a coordinate, the name of the coordinate here. If I fixed 0 and minus 1, I cannot fix this one. It will be some number. I will denote it an. So this is renormalized coordinate of this point is an. And it's basically ratio of this interval to that interval, to length of this interval. That renormalized coordinate of this point is something which I cannot also control at this point. I denoted minus bn because it's negative. Now also notice that I draw picture this way, but actually which one will be left and which will be right depend on whether n is even or odd, so it switches orientation, but it's not essential for me. So you want to study the thing for different maps. And I will be studying it later on for the map with parameter C fixed, but I will start, we can just start discussion with C equal to 1. So C equal to 1 is a case when there is no break. They're the same numbers. So it's a diffeomorphism case. And this was well studied, and that is a realm of linearization theory discussed by Marmi. So this is Erman theory, and many people contributed here. So basically the result is that if map is smooth enough and C2 plus alpha is enough for that, and rho is Diophantine, or typical number, full measure set of numbers, actually Diophantine properties should depend on alpha, then you can smoothly conjugate two maps. However, in this case, these two maps, there is a distinguished representative for diffeomorphism, just linear diffeomorphism with slope 1. So then you conjugate giving t to this linear one and that linearization theory. And this can be done. Now, what does it mean? If you start with a linear map with slope 1, so if you start with this one giving by this slope 1, of course, slope will not change. You iterate how many times you iterate, it will be still slope 1. So basically, these two things for linear map will be linear function of z. And for linear map, you can easily calculate that it will be z plus an. And this one will be z. So this one is taking 0 to minus 1. So it's z minus 1. So that's what you'll get if you do this renormalization scheme for linear map in slope 1. And what you want to show is that if you do it for any diffeomorphism, any, not close to linear, but any one with rotation number rho, this thing will converge to that one. It will look the same. Now, An, you can calculate here. It's an arithmetical quantity because it's a linear case. And An will be given by truncated continued fraction starting with kn plus 1, and so on. So it's a it's a number which is well defined to depend on your continued fraction. So what you want really to show, the derivatives of these maps are close to 1. And that would indicate everywhere the derivative is close to 1, then it's a linear function. So the aim in this theory is to show that derivative of fn prime is close to 1 when n goes to infinity. And the derivative of this map, of course, doesn't change because it's so fine. It's the same as derivative of tqn. So you want to say that tqn, if you differentiate it at every point in a circle, then it's close to 1. If you manage to do this, you're done. I mean, then you get certain rigidity result. The randomization converges, and you get certain rigidity result. You have to work on it. You have to use definite conditions. But basically, it's well-defined, well-established thing. Now, it's possible to prove. It's not very hard. But what I want to say is that imagine that you do the same scheme, but and you use two smooth pieces, but they have break point. Now, of course, when you move, then in case of break, so for diffeomorphism, you can take any point x0. For break, you take break point as a starting point of your procedure. And then when you move this interval many, many times until it comes back, it never touches this point. So you never really encounter this break thing. And this interval, it goes, it never encounter the thing. It never covers this point until this time. So you kind of iterate two smooth pieces all the time of small intervals. And then there is a kind of very conceptual fact that when you iterate too many times smooth functions on small intervals, then the resulting map is going to be not linear. It's going to be fractional linear. So there is a very conceptual fact that which is easy to prove that Fn and Gn actually converges to the space of fractional linear maps. Rather than linear maps. Now, linear maps is a particular class of fractional linear maps, but very particular. Now, and in case of the circle differences with break, you really will have fractional linear maps, which are never linear. And this thing is governed by the following, actually, fact. There is a way to understand if you have several break points, for example, when you can have linear things and when you will not have linear, when you have fractional linear things. The fact is very simple. You have to take integral of the second derivative of your map divided by first derivative of your map, which is positive, and integrate it over circle. And if this integral is zero, then you have linear case, or piecewise linear case if you have many breaks. But if the integral is non-zero, then you will have fractional linear. And that's very easy to understand. And maybe I'll not at this point discuss it, but it's a very simple fact. And so what it gives to you that immediately, just on this conceptual level, you reduce your problem from infinite dimensional one, because t can be anything. It's a functional space of maps with, of a circle, to actually, finite dimensional one with very few parameters characterizing it. This is a linear map, and this is fractional linear map. So this one characterized by three parameters, this characterized by less parameters. So actually, if you calculate parameters correctly, and you think about it a little bit, it turns out that in fractional linear case, these parameters An and Bn completely characterize the maps which you'll encounter. So the whole thing will depend just on two parameters, An and Bn. So what it says that starting with infinite dimensional space, you converge to a plane depending on two parameters, and randomization will be effectively renormalization. And randomization transformation is transformation which take Fn, Gn to Fn plus 1, Gn plus 1, will be effectively two-dimensional transformation. And then you have to study it. I'll be more specific about this fractional linear map in a little bit later. But at this point, I want to formulate first theorem. And this theorem is the final theorem for the maps with one break, and it was proved, was published last year. It's a theorem which we proved with Sasha Kosich. And this theorem says the following: that translation converge. If you start conversion from this one and that one, they converge. Now, converge is a bad word. Then they converge to something. They approach each other. But people say convergence of randomization anyway. And they converge with exponential rate. And this exponential rate is universal rate. It doesn't depend on T1 and T2. It depends only on number C and nothing else. Of course, it also depends on smoothness. So, but if I fix alpha in class of smoothness, then what theorem says that they exist lambda depending on C, which is less than 1, such that for any two T1, T2 with the same size of break, no, it's not less, it's not equal to 1, and with the same irrational rotation number. And here you don't need to put a diophantine condition. For convergence of rotation, you don't need it. Only for rigidity, you need it. Then, fn1z minus fn2z, say, in C2 topology on minus 1, 0, that's where they define the z goes from minus 1 to 0. The norm is less or equal than constant, which depend on T1 and T2, times lambda to the n. So they're exponentially convergent to each other with rate lambda c, which is less than 1. And that's a final result on the level of randomization theory. So they any two randomization approach each other. Again, I want to emphasize that it's the effect which we see in all randomization schemes, that to get convergence randomization, you don't need to put diophantine conditions. Diophantine conditions are needed only later to deduce from this that there is a rigidity. And there is a rigidity result which follows from this. And this is a theorem which says, I'll formulate it the following way. There exists a set of full Lebesgue measure of rotation numbers such that if say set A, if rho belongs to A, then T1 and T2 are C1 conjugate. So which means that this T2 is equal to phi, how did I put it, phi minus 1 of phi. I think I put it phi minus 1. Phi minus 1, T1 phi, where phi is C1 on a circle. Now, you can say much more about this set of rotation numbers. Actually, it's more than full Lebesgue measure. So what we allow is that integers in continued fraction expansion can grow even exponentially fast with n. So basically, it's a little bit funny situation. And I'll say about this few words. There is even odd phenomena here. And for even positions, it depends on whether C is greater than 1 or less than 1. But either on even or odd positions, you don't need to put any restrictions on K, no diophantine condition. But on other positions, you have to put condition. And this condition is you can allow exponential growth. And so they have the same rotation number rho. Thank you. And so that is a result of Sasha Kosich and Elio Matsea. And it will be published soon. Now, Sasha Kosich has also results showing that this C1 cannot be much improved in general. So for many rotation numbers, you can improve it. Say, for bounded type, it can be improved to C1 plus something. And that was known for some time. Sasha proved that you cannot prove this result for C1 plus epsilon for any epsilon. So basically, the theorem of Sasha and the paper was, as far as I understand, was just accepted to communications in the following one, that so they exist a set called A1 of rotation numbers, of full measure. So there is a set of full measure of rotation numbers such that for any row from this set, and for any epsilon positive, they exist T1, T2 with the same rotation number being equal to rho. For which conjugacy is not C1 plus epsilon, for which phi does not belong to C1 plus epsilon. So you cannot really extend it to larger class. But of course, for bounded type, you can do it. Yeah, there are counterexamples where it's not C1, it's not full measured set. So for bad rotation numbers, we can construct examples where it's not C1. And actually, we're proving result, but there is still certain regularity. And the result is that conjugacy would not be arbitrary bad. I mean, for diffeomorphism, conjugacy can be arbitrary bad if rotation number is real bad. Here, it will not be C1, it will not be Lipschitz. We can construct these examples, but it still will be Hölder with exponent close to 1. So for any epsilon positive, it will be Hölder 1 minus epsilon Hölder. But I'm not going into it. It's still a little bit of delicate. Say it again. No, it's not even C1. It's not even Lipschitz. And no. So it really can be singular, this conjugacy. OK, it's a good question, because for maps with a critical point, you actually can prove that for all irrational rotation numbers, C1 conjugacy holds. But for this singularity, you don't have this robust rigidity. You have some traces of this robust rigidity, but not here. Anyway, so let me explain what's going on here and why this theorem was so difficult to prove and it took so long time, and what is the main point here. Say it again? No, I cannot have. We can see the map without critical points. Yeah, it's without critical points. That's essential. No critical points. I should put it here. So T prime is strictly positive. All right, meaning that at the breakpoint, it's also both of them are positive. All right, so there are two phenomena here. One is convergence to the space of fractional linear maps, which I said depend on two parameters. And I want to show that the map is concrete. I would just write some formula. Don't be scared. I mean, they're not very scary formula, but there's concrete formula. So let me draw it here. And because of this plus minus, say, changing of rotation symmetry, you actually, the picture I will draw will have two parts. So I would introduce a class of fractional linear maps, which is invariant class for the renovation transformation. And then I apply, describe renovation transformation. So VF, AV, C, C is the parameter here on Z. That is A plus CZ divided by 1 minus VZ. And then G, this is the same F and G, but they're capital now. I'll see connection in a moment. That will be equal to AZ minus C divided by AC plus z times 1 plus v minus c. Now, parameters here are not a and b, as I described here, geometrical parameters a, n, and b, and parameters are a and v, and connection between v and b is the following. So a is the same as a n, the same meaning, and v has the following meaning. It's c minus a n minus b n divided by b n. It's more convenient to use this coordinate rather than b coordinate, but otherwise it's the same thing. All right, so this is invariant set for randomization. So randomization acts on those maps, and resulting map will be in the same class. So how it does? You do the following. You take images of point minus 1, so 0, if you plug 0 here, zero goes to A. This map, zero goes to minus one. So what you do, you take point minus one and start to iterate it by this map. So it will be F on minus one, and then next one maybe, second iterate of minus one, until you cross from one side to another side of zero. You start at minus one, and then you do monotonically. And here, say, k's iterate of minus one is negative, and k's plus one iterate of minus one is positive. At this moment, you stop, and then you calculate new f and g. So if you started with f and g, so the new one will be the following. So new f will be k's iterate of f and iterate it with g. So you started, maybe I'll start with g and then iterate f k times. And then new g will be just old f. But you also have to change coordinate system because your coordinate system will be based on this point being minus 1. And now that point will be minus 1. So actually, you have to calculate it. The new coordinate system will be 0 will stay there, and you have minus a n. So if you take a new z, I would have to multiply by a n, and this is minus 1 over a n. And this is minus 1 over a n minus a n z. So that's how randomization acts on this family f and g. And of course, effectively, it just acts on parameters a and v. So you just calculate new parameters a and v. So you started with av, which is denoted here anvn. And then after you apply randomization transformation, you get new parameter a prime v prime, or a tilde v tilde, which actually corresponds to an plus 1 vn plus 1. So this is two-dimensional map, but of course it's got a lot of discontinuities because the number of times you iterate depends on what you started with, on your rotation number. Nevertheless, you can study this dynamical system, two-dimensional dynamical system, and it inhabits very strong hyperbolic properties, and that's the key to study this transformation, hyperbolicity of this transformation. So what you can prove, and this is some work, and this basically was done in our paper with Teplinsky, you can prove the following picture. I delete Hermann part. That so the play of parameter AV, this is C less than one, and this is C greater than one. There is a certain domain. This is point C minus 1. This is C minus 1 over 2. This is C. And there is a certain domain where all dynamics happen. So this is a tractor. Everything ends up in this domain. And there is a similar domain here. C minus 1 will be negative. C will be less than 1. There is a certain domain here. And so you'll have curves corresponding to smooth curves corresponding to irrational rotation numbers. So A and parameters A and V corresponding to maps with the rational rotation numbers. And they will be stable manifolds for randomization. So if points belong to the thing, there is universal convergence, uniform convergence of them with exponential rate. So if they lie on the same stable manifold. But there is also unstable manifolds along which you go away. So there is a horseshoe structure with uniform expansion and contraction rate here and here. So what happened, point from here maps here and then goes back. So it's kind of period two thing. So there is a structure of stable and unstable manifolds. And actually, there's a counterset here and here, invariant and universal counterset, which depend only on parameter C. And points under observation converges to corresponding points of a counterset. So it's as good as you want to prove. I mean, there is a horseshoe, there is hyperbolic horseshoe, uniform hyperbolic horseshoe, and that's what's going on here. And you can prove that everything is nice on this picture. There is also, as I said, conceptual exponential convergence to this picture, starting from any map with a break. Now you want to combine these two together, and that's very hard. Because here, you have convergence only when rotation number is the same. But when you converge to this plane, it's very difficult to control rotation number. And that's why the results which were available before this paper with Kocsis were only for restricted class of rotation numbers, for which there is no difficulty which I'll describe now, which is called unbounded geometry. So what I discuss now is very different from the case of diffeomorphism and from the case of critical circle maps. You can see this phenomenon only here. So this just describes why Diophantine conditions are needed in this case, in case of break singularity and other things. All right. So what means Diophantine condition? It means that certain condition of a growth of these integer numbers kn, that they cannot grow too much. When they grow too fast, you get some problem. So what kind of problem you will see? And problem is the following, that if you look at the map of fn, and fn is defined between minus 1 and 0, this map, it doesn't cross diagonal, it doesn't have fixed point, otherwise it's not a regular map, is some monotone function here. And say typically, say for something like this, for example, and then what we do, we iterate point minus 1 until we cross 0. And if this graph is very close to the thing, then you will iterate many, many times until you go and cross 0. And even if you have control of how good is this function here on step n, if the number of iterations is huge, you're losing the control, or you may lose this control. Now, it turns out that behavior here is also well controlled because it's always parabolic singularities, almost touching, almost tangency here, you can control it. So this is well-defined thing. It's not a problem I wanted to discuss. This is a unbounded but pretty much bounded geometry anyway. The difficulty in break case is that sometimes graph doesn't look like this. Again, this is even odd situation, and for even or odd cases, depending on whether C is greater than 1 or less than 1, you will not face this one. You face this one in half of the cases, even or odd. But the other one, you will see the following situation, that your graph would look the following way. It will be function which comes very close to diagonal, not in the middle, but at the end point. So the trajectory of the break point is very close to be periodic. And what will happen that the graph will have such a form. So it's not zero here. But derivative here is close to C, this number C. I assume that C is greater than 1. And here to 1 over C. So overall, product is equal to 1. It's kind of similar to this derivative equal to 1. But it is something with derivative greater than 1 and this is less. And you have huge number of iterates. But these iterates, when you start to iterate, say you go from here, you get a lot of very short intervals. So the intervals here, they start to accumulate. They're very short, and there are many of them. And the size of them will be of the order of E, or say, 1 over C in power kn plus 1 over 2. So kn plus 1 is the number of iterates we will see on the next step. half of them here, half of them there, and these intervals are getting very small. And those intervals are also getting very small because 1 over c is here. So you get very small intervals accumulating here and there. And then boundly, they are really very, very small, and you have to deal with this situation. Now, the difficulty is that if k is much larger than n, say n squared, can be anything, then this is much smaller than exponential. But our control is only exponentially good. So we cannot get anything better than exponential in convergence to over normalizations. But here we are facing numbers which are much smaller than that, and you have to control this. And apparently it can be done. And that is done in a paper with Sasha Kosic, so that you can deal with the difficulty and prove that still normalization will converge even in this situation, even with this very unbounded geometry. All right, now let me just use the last 5 minutes to describe an important feature which I didn't discuss yet. It's an important feature which allows you to prove hyperbolicity of this picture. Now, it's kind of a complicated system. How you can, in principle, prove hyperbolicity? So it's a two-dimensional map. You want to prove that there is one unstable direction. Now, it turns out that this map, this relation map, which takes AV and transform it for given C and transform it to A tilde V tilde, and actually to nu C, which will be 1 over C, it's kind of switching from C to 1 over C, this map have a symmetry. And I will write formula for the symmetry. It's just what, on this formula level, you can see the symmetry. And it should have geometrical interpretation. I always say it has geometrical interpretation. I don't know this geometrical interpretation. So we see this symmetry. It's time reversal symmetry. But we don't know really what is behind it. So the symmetry is the following. It's concrete involution, which take A and V into C minus 1 minus V, AV, minus V over C. And it turns out that inverse relation map, which you can define, is conjugate by this involution with a direct relation map. So this is time reversal symmetry, which indication of certain, usually indication of certain symplectic structure and Hamiltonian structure. In two-dimensional case, it's kind of exact, that if you have this symmetry, then you will have symplectic structure. But in multidimensional case, it's not exactly one-to-one. Anyway, if you have the symmetry, what it gives to you? If you know that there's unstable direction, this gives you that there exists a stable direction. So if you know that for any combinatorics row, there's unstable direction, then it shows that it also has stable direction for any combinatorics row, just by symmetry, because stable because of the symmetry. Now, and where instability comes from? Instability comes from rotation number, because there is always instability in rotation number. You have to fix rotation number in order to see stable manifold. But along the direction of increased rotation number, there is an unstable direction. And that's relatively easy to prove. So if you prove that, then you can prove hyperbolicity of this picture. Now, it's a very good conceptual explanation. However, in the paper with Teplinsky, we prove it the other way. We prove that there is stability, and then we get instability another way, which is not the ideal way, but it's possible to do also. Anyway, the symmetry is very important, a part of the game. And now I want to say that the direction which we are moving now is a direction very closely related to what, again, they discussed Marby, but it's again another setting. Not linearizable interval exchanges, but interval exchanges which are essentially fraction linear. And we are staying on the level of maps of a circle, so it corresponds to interval exchanges with a genus 1, as discussed by Marby. So that means that you are having circle maps. Circle maps are important because in this case you have Danjoua theory, so you know when maps are topologically conjugate to each other. But what will happen in this case is we want to consider, say, many breakpoints, finite number of breakpoints. Breakpoints. So you have two maps, T1 and T2, and both have k breakpoints. So let me call it y1, yk breakpoints for t1 and say z1, zk. I'm sorry for that. It's not randomized coordinate. Breakpoints for t2. And they have certain sizes of breaks, c1, ck, and those also have c1, ck. So we say the two maps are break equivalent. Break equivalent if they exist a topological conjugacy, homeo phi, which conjugate them. That's not big deal. Any two with a rational rotation number are conjugated with the same rational rotation number. But we want this conjugacy to put a breakpoint into breakpoint. So this conjugacy is such that topological conjugacy, such that zi goes to yi by this conjugacy. So they're conjugated corresponding point with the corresponding breaks. So on the break level, on singularity level, they're the same. And of course, we also assume that if there is a conjugacy, the rotation number is the same. And so the conjecture, yet it's still conjecture, it's still work in progress, but we have certain progress in understanding the thing, is that if you have the thing, then again there is rigidity, that you can upgrade this conjugacy to be C1 conjugacy. And I put it as a conjecture. Under some Diophantine conditions, phi is C1. But second part of the conjecture, that without any Diophantine condition, the randomization will converge. The randomization constructed for one and for another converge exponentially fast. And then you can ask, what are the randomizations? And we're having a randomization scheme here, which is different from Rossi induction, which was discussed by Marmi. It's another induction scheme for this kind of interval exchange information. It is not interval exchange information, but what we call intervals exchange scheme. So our first return map is defined on small intervals which surround the breakpoints, y1, yk. So each of the breakpoints is surrounded by small intervals, and these small intervals are changing by the maps. So instead of one interval exchange, where they're connected, they're disconnected, but they are completely going one into another. And there are combinatorial, finite number of combinatorial schemes of these things. And what is important, that we can see similar symmetry acting in this randomization. So the coordinate system is important because then you can see symmetry. And this symmetry we can see, and this is much less trivial than here because here it's just one combinatorics, basically, or two, C goes to one over C. Here there are many combinatorics. And symmetry is taking randomization map with one combinatorics connected with another combinatorics. But still it's symmetry. So still, if you can prove that there are K and stable direction, you get stable direction for free. And that's the line of research which we are pursuing right now, and I think it's very promising. Anyway, there is an interesting topic of extending the theory of interval exchanges and Rossi induction and Zorich-Kontsevich cocycles from realm of maps with slope 1, which is interval exchanges, to realm of either piecewise linear maps with different slopes or fractional linear maps. And these two worlds exist, and they have nice hyperbolic properties. And I stop here. Thank you.